Let's pick up Massey, pick up Joe, throw him in the truck and go to 90. Not a worry, not a care. Maybe we'll see Tina there in 90. Past the village, past Lucy's, past the bus stop, to the sea. Judith and Harry and Gavin and me, we'll meet you by the coconut tree. We don't mind rain or shine, long as you're there, and that is fine. The grass is green, the sky is blue, the sun is yellow, and we love you. The grass is green, the sky is blue, the sun is yellow, and we love you. From Nangonga to Nandala.
I saw Naqaqa for the first time from the island. I was snorkeling out there, and I decided to snorkel all the way in here and see if there was a way into this land, but it was all jungle. There was no way into it. A few days later, I came back and found this same area, the jungle, from the roadside, and I put on a wetsuit and put on reef shoes, and because it was just such aggressive jungle, no way to take five steps into it. And I got two guys with K-knives, and they walked ahead of me, and we cut a little path through the jungle, finally found a way to the ocean. And we were standing on top of some rock, and I thought, this is the place to build an amazing house.
Naqaqa is just not about this piece of land. It's about more very important things that involve the lives of other people. But it's more than that. Naqaqa is like part of most of the Fijians' life around our area. We were so blessed that we were offered with so many assistance from Naqaqa. And the amazing thing is just not around my village or just Sapsau. It goes far enough from other islands like Kiowa Island, Rembi Island, Tavuni Island. Naqaqa, if you talk about Naqaqa, most of the people they knew. Oh, that's Naqaqa, that's where they supplied us with the school supplies, like libraries, with the housing materials. That's why this place is so special. It's not just about the land itself, but it's about the heart of what's happening in here, in Naqaqa. So we were really blessed to be part of this organization, this small place with so many good things about it.
If you're happy all the time, people will see, it will come out in your face that you are a happy person. Come in, come is, we sharing, we, you know, like, we make something happy. You're trying 1 hour or just to come and laugh and sing and socialize with others, and so you come. I will sit down. Even I sit down with them 1 hour or 2 hours, that's okay to me. But even if I don't drink kava, I will sit with them until they finish. We just drinking kava. The very important things in drinking kava, like joking. Joking is that's a good time for us. Like you can laugh, you can happy. Some joking is very funny, and you know.
So the first thing we built here was the beginning of what I never realized would be a 20-year project. We never stopped building. We just kept going. And I had this idea that Fiji had really spoken to me, and that is Fiji is about healing. And I thought of this place as being about healing. And one after another, friends that I invited were people who had just been diagnosed with cancer, or just lost a spouse, or just lost a parent, or just lost a job. And they were people who needed to come here to heal and to have this kind of peace. My idea was that we'd have a main house where people could come when they wanted community, but everybody would have their own guest house that they could go to when they wanted to be solitary, when they wanted quiet and peaceful time. And I always loved that. If I went to somebody's house as a guest, I loved the idea that they'd just say, there's your place, we leave you alone, come out when you want to, and we'll all be together in the main house. And so we built that main house, and we built all these guest houses that were connected by bridges through the jungle. And these bridges would be the way you'd get, some cases, a quarter mile away from the main house. So you might have the tree house that was built up in this giant tree up here behind us. You might have the beach house at the other end, the deck house, the cove house, the jungle house, all of these different places where people could sort of stake their own area and then only come together for meals if they wanted to in the main house. The first person who got involved in helping here, and the one who is still here amazingly, is Tula. And he was in his late teens. He was absolutely gifted with wood. He could just do anything with carpentry. And he and I have formed a partnership over these years of looking at a space and saying, you think we could build it this way? You think we could get 2 pine poles and they'd be strong enough to support it? We've had failures. We've had things we had to tear down. But we've had a whole bunch of successes of building things, some of them really quick. We built the beach house in 6 weeks. We built the tree house in 6 weeks. And had a lot of fun doing it. And something I was just amazed to see is that I'd be in the main house and I'd be watching guys work in the hot sun, and they'd be singing. They'd be out there singing, they'd be out there having fun. And it was a good contrast for what you'd see in construction, let's say working with some, you know, construction company in America. Here the people were genuinely happy to be doing it. They were proud of what they built. And almost everybody that worked with us on those original products 20 years ago is still here at Naqaqa and still working on projects.
I think Fiji is the best place in the world. I like Fiji the best because the way of living in Fiji is very nice, with living like Fijians. And we don't have boundaries around us, and time does not care over here. That's the main part. I born in Fiji. I was the only one Indian working with all of these Fijians. I had about 40 staff sometimes when we were doing these projects and building the houses over here. And all from Nandi, Naqaqa, and Vivili village. And I really enjoy working with them, and very fun working with them. Fun is that, I mean, like working with them, you know, they have more strong power, and you know, what you cannot do, they can do it, and you can use them. And then we use it, make the job as fun with them. You know, say we have to lift a post or something, And then they're very strong. So, you know, and then there's some jokes while we're doing those jokes. And then our tools becomes our instrument, and our jokes and, you know, stories from the village becomes our song. And then we keep going, I mean, keep walking. And the job was goes very good that way. Once you know them and they know you, you can rely everything on them, and it's so, so good. We live like a family over here, and you know, days and months and years, things happen in family, and then we work as a one family. Naqaqa is the first one to look after that, what happened, or you know, to celebrate, or to sometimes some sadness happen. It's just very nice. It just makes your heart, you know, you are not alone. You are binded, you know, with a very good family and staff. Special about Naqaqa is maybe by Gavin. He has so much love to Naqaqa. We just like Naqaqa the best. We're just very happy. Everybody's happy.
Naqaqa is an amazing place. It's an amazing family, I'd say, to be part of. And I've been blessed with 11 years of being here, of helping Gavin, of working with all these different staffs here. I've been so blessed with the difference that we all brought in, not only as an individual, but the villages that we come from. We are not that much different after all. We value the same things. And we are here for exactly the same purpose, to build up this family for those that comes in from abroad to get to love and to get to share the experience with. We have a lot of people here that shares a great sense of laughter. We play a lot. We laugh a lot. Yeah, we do things together a lot. As if you may see, we usually eat together and share our lunch together as a family. It's pretty much just that extension of the family that we live in back in the village to what we experience and what we share here. It is an amazing place to be part of. I wouldn't change anything for that. I wouldn't change anything for that. And I love all of the staff that works here. The thing that I usually encourage our staff with is that make Naqaqa be a memory to those that comes through it. Let them make memories with Naqaqa. They don't only come to a place, but they come to a person, meeting you personally, getting to know you. You are more important than the beauty of the place. It's how you approach the guest. It's how you interact with them. It's how you express how much you love and you care. What I usually tell them is that love is universal. You don't have to say it by words. You show it with your smile. You show it with your walk. You show it with what you do, and they'll pick it right away that you are someone special. You are someone with that gift of love that the Western world comes usually searching for when they come through our shores. And if there's something that we can give them from a smile or from a kind gesture, that's our gift to them. That's our gift to them, yeah.
I really wanted each guest house to be its own little haven, a place you could go and hang out And if you didn't want to see people, you didn't have to see people. And if you wanted community, you could come to the main house. You could, you know, have a long bridge from your guest house through the jungle, find your way to the main house. And thus, I knew that people could be left alone when they wanted to be alone, and they could be together when they wanted to be together. And that has really worked. It's worked for me, because I also can retreat into my guest house, and it's worked for guests who know that they're not bothered at all. Another thing we've got here is, in every guest house, there's a little piece of fabric you can tie around your wrist. And if you tie that around your wrist, it means you don't want to talk. And so you can walk around the property and people won't bug you, and you can just have quiet time. And occasionally I'll see a guest start to say something, and then I see that little piece of fabric, and I'm quiet. When Naqaqa started, it was just a jungle. There was absolutely nothing here. And the good part of that is that we had to create everything ourselves. My dear friend Ed Begley talked me through getting a solar power system, because he knows all about that stuff, great conservationist. And so when we put in the first solar power system, and we turned on that first light, and I thought, oh my God, we're getting this without a utility company, without burning fuel. It was a fantastic joy. And now we've got a really big solar system here because we've got all these buildings.
I always have the advice for people, like, if they want to save the world, this is like free power. Solar system is one of the cleanest power, and it's like environmental free. With us, we don't have a threat in our mind that there's going to be a blackout in Naqaqa.
Then we had to deal with water. We had to find it. And so the best place to find it was to drill down, and we had a crew come here, and we have our own artesian well. And so we've got Fiji water coming out of every tap here, and that's been a big gift. Our own fire system, fire hoses and fire stations around the property, our own roads, our own driveways, everything had to be done on our own. And that was really a pleasure, and it made this place self-contained. It's all here. But then we needed food, so we have our own 25-acre organic farm. Basically, everything you could want, and certainly everything that I want, is here in this place.
This is walu. Walu is a kind of fish that is a deep, from the deep ocean. I love cooking. I start from home, from my mother, learn how to cook.
My dad taught me to cook.
That's great.
So if it's just traditional, it's just be the fish marinated inland with the fresh coconut, just that.
Or onion.
Or onion, we got Fijian onion.
I hope you will love your meal tonight.
Absolutely,
yeah,
I'm sure.
Thank you.
Yeah,
beautiful.
Yes.
Okay. I had a friend who visited here and he said, take care of this place, Gav. He said, Nike is coming down the road. Electricity is coming down the road. And when I first got here, it was a dirt road, no electricity, no telephones. We brought in the first phone poles. We saw it changing over the years. And because of what he said, I kept buying properties next to Nanganga if something became available. And there was one maybe fifth acre parcel, very, very small. And I contacted the people, there were a couple in Australia, and I said, would you sell me this piece of property? And they said, yeah, but there's only one tree on it. There's just a banyan tree on it. There's nothing else on it. And that's what I wanted. I wanted this unbelievable banyan tree, 200 feet high. We eventually built a tree house in it, 40 feet off the ground. And we know that tree house is being slowly crushed by the tree because the tree has got its vines all around it. The railings now leading up to that tree house are made of what originally started as little hair-thin fibers. And the Fijians wrapped them around each other and they eventually grew into great big thick railings going up to the tree house. So that was a great purchase, that one, this little property that was useless and turned out to run the tree house for us.
This shower that's 45 feet up in the air, a real engineering feat, and we've got water up here, hot and cold running water, and lights at night, and if you look over here, all the railings are made by the actual tree itself, and it's a good thing because falling down there is a real fall, and that's how you get a tree house.
Then where the beach house is, we didn't own that either. We negotiated hard to get that little piece of property and got it and eventually put in the beach house and then the one next to it and the one next to it and the one next to it to where we have a lot of land here. So a dear friend of mine who came here a lot and really loved Fiji and was a big teacher to me, I built the whole beach house for he and his wife. And he said, but what you need is a hot bath. And I said, absolutely wrong. You don't need a hot bath. It's the tropics. About the last thing you ever want to do is have a hot bath. But I built one and then built another because he was right and I was wrong. Having a hot bath after you're snorkeling or after your scuba diving is a great thing.
Like Nanganga for me, work is also an opportunity for me to do lots of things. One of the things is just working with kids. So we look after kids from ages 2 to 4 years of age. Let them be kids. Yeah, I like working with kids, yeah.
You know, in the early years that I was in Fiji, I was doing a lot of charitable work, and I remember calling my business manager and saying, it's fantastic, you know, the dollar, the Fijian dollar is worth half what the US dollar is worth. This is great, the dollar goes so far. And he said, no, 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 the way you're spending right now, it's costing you double the dollar. It's costing you $2,000 to give a $1,000 donation because you're having to pay tax to earn that money. And so that's when we formed Naqaqa Giving Foundation. And so that's a private foundation that is tax exempt and can do all kinds of things. And we've done a lot, but our biggest project by far is the private clinic in Savu-Savu, which is a town down the road from us here. And that clinic has provided care to thousands of people, and it's by far the best medical facility on this island, and very well regarded, and something I'm the most proud of. So we had this fantastic building, we built out the clinic, and it was wonderful, and we had everything except that feature you always need for a clinic, which is a physician. That we did not have. Nor could we find one, because every Fijian doctor was working for the government. It's hard to compete with the government. But I got the district health officer who covers this island and four other islands, and I showed him the facility, and I said, would you take this job, and would you be willing to leave the government position and take this job? And he said, no, I would not be willing to do that. And I worked on him for a year. And after a year, he finally said yes. And he now successfully, that's Dr. Ishak, who successfully runs our clinic for us. He would never go back to government now. He loves the job he's got. He loves the ability to help so many people and to be a hands-on physician.
And Gavin's approach was such a fatherly type of approach. And the need was here, so I decided to stay back. And I'm originally from this island, and my wife is also from this island. It's the most beautiful place in Fiji also. Since it is a semi-private, certain things we do free here, like we do free blood sugar check, we do free dressing, and there are list of patients who need assistance, they are seen free.
And it's the NGF project that has been the biggest and the longest and the most successful.
You want me to sing right now?
Yes.
Goya una seni mokosoi, nungu tumbu na kau maroroi, aunda seto ka aunda ngoroi, daundivi na kau maroroi. That's a song about one flower in Fiji. I don't know, any flower Fiji is. Smell like this flower or no? But that's the best flower in Fiji. It's a very nice smell. Maybe one day before you leave, I will get that flower for you to smell that flower. Mokosoi oilei oilei na seni mo kosoi mai buna diva diva na seni mokosoi.
Oh, warm wind, an island wind, once took me across the sea. It was a warm wind, an island wind, that didn't melt the heart in me. And now I am in colder climes, with all my cares and fears. And it's a warm wind, an island wind, that whispers in my ears. You're a tired girl, city girl, who toils across the sea. As if every single day's your last, and missing all that's free. Like coral reefs and floating underneath a starry, starry sky. Oh, tired girl, city girl, come home before you die. Thank you. return to the children that I've known. And maybe when I do, they'll have children of their own. And they will laugh the sweetest laugh and hold me by my hand. And I won't have to talk that much, and they will understand. Was a warm wind, an island wind, that took me across the sea. It was a warm wind, an island wind, that didn't melt this heart in me. And with many miles between us now, his voice comes o'er the sea. Yes, he calls me my salty friend. Come home, come home to me.
People fishing on the reef are like part of nature here. They're out there at sunset, and even in the middle of the night, you will see them lit by lanterns. Many nights, I look out over the reef and see their lights dancing with the stars. And those are the nights I sleep the best.
Tonight, the sky seemed so perfect with stars. You'd think the moon would hide her face. But when we looked for that circle of light, she rose and took her place. Send us a quiet night. Send us a quiet night. Send us a quiet night. Send us quiet
Sayani be iko isalei That's Leah.